You need to be a little bit louder so that it can capture your voice also, right? Start karte hain. You can start.
Okay, good evening. My name is Vaibhav. I have been a photographer since 2009, and I started my journey as a still photographer, making my way into motion picture photography within 3 to 4 years of time. And I've stick to cinematography for 4 years now, since 2013. I'm going to take the class on cinematography. So I'll be talking basically very general language. I'm going to talk about very basic grammar of cinematography, camera, and filmmaking at the same time, because cinematography independently doesn't really stand alone. It doesn't really stand alone in terms of because it's a whole package when it comes to film. Film is about telling a story basically, and you need audio, you need visual, and you need a story to basically communicate something. You need to say something. So basically, cinematography is one aspect of filmmaking. So I'm going to start by quoting Robert Bresson. So he says cinematography is a writing with images in movement and in sound. So he doesn't, like you see, he doesn't leave sound in outside of cinematography. So I mean, it's very much, it goes hand in hand. So okay, so let's start. I'm going to take two topics, camera lenses and camera angles. So let's start with camera lenses. There are two sides of photography, any photography, call it still or motion. There's a technical side and there's an aesthetic side. So the technical side is basically, it helps you get the job done. So for example, you have to say something, and if you're not strong aesthetically and you're strong technically, or if you're not strong technically and strong aesthetically, it won't, like, there has to be a balance, because to communicate something you need both. You need the technical knowledge so that you can you know that how you achieve a particular emotion or what magnification to use. That's all that all comes under technical knowledge. Aesthetic is basically to transfer a sense. For example, if it's a dark scene, the story is this confusion. Basically, if the director wants to transfer confusion confusion into his viewer, so so aesthetics are basically transferring emotions, going beyond the technical knowledge itself, just not a good looking shot, but communicating emotion overall, generally. So I would start with the technical side of camera lenses. There are particular focal lengths available in camera lenses. So there are 16mm is called a prime, is a wide lens. 24mm is again a wide lens. So basically, it's very, in a very layman's term, I would say, considering 50mm is as your focal length, is the normal angle of view. I mean, 50mm is basically closest to what humans see, the angle of view, and it's very almost close to what we see. Anything below 50mm would be considered a wide angle, because you are seeing more than what a normal human eye would see. And anything beyond 50mm will be a telephoto lens, because you are seeing a compressed version, a narrower version of what actually humans see in normal day-to-day life. So that's how lenses have been segregated. I would also like to tell you that understanding cinematography and camera, basically, I mean, if you take it personally, if you understand it through your body, then the learning goes deep and it stays with you in the longer run. So like I always say, I mean, your human our body is a camera in itself. I mean below the neck, it's all battery. Cerebellum is the does the memory recording work, and the mind, the four prefrontal cortex would do the processing like in a camera. And your eyelids are basically the shutter and the pupils are the aperture. I mean, if you understand it like that, you're constantly, you know, you're a camera that's moving. I mean, if you understand the basic principles of photography, I mean, it's only shutter, aperture, it's how you control light. I mean, your body does that automatically. It's just you need to give it more attention, understand how you the visuals are going in and how what emotions are they evoking, whatever you see, the colors that you see. I mean, bright red would evoke a particular emotion and yellow would evoke a particular other emotion. I mean, if you're receptive to all of this, I think it helps you in saying a lot when it comes to storytelling. So the basic lenses that are available are 16mm, 24mm, 35mm, 50mm, 85, 100, 200. It goes beyond like that. There are two types of lenses, the technology of lenses, anamorphic and spherical. Anamorphic lenses came into existence basically when the crop sensors came. Okay, let's move on to let's just touch a little bit on the aesthetics of camera lenses. What lensing would do to a particular emotion or a story. I mean, it is very important, lensing becomes very important when telling a story and also giving you a sense of space that you're recording in, whatever the location is, whatever you're shooting, because the camera is seeing, camera is the eye basically in a story, in a visual format. There are three grounds, lensing again, you can choose which ground to focus more on, like foreground, middle ground and background. Each, if you choose the depth of field in either of these grounds, you'll get a different emotion altogether. So that will be very interesting to explore in terms of storytelling. Distortion and compression, again, distortion is when you go wide. It's distortion is basically anything which is unreal, which is not normal, so to say. So anything, if the visual is a little twisted towards from the ends, from the corners, anything, that's known as distortion. Perspective is again how the subject appears on camera. Is he flat? Is he close to the camera? There'll be a different perspective. Is he further away? His face will swell beyond normal, so that'll be a perspective again. So how you see the image is perspective. Let's move on to camera angles. There are five basic general areas in camera angles. Composition is anything that a camera is pointing at, that is composition. And it can be called as a camera angle because you're placing a camera, and anything that a camera looks at is a camera angle. It can be on the axis, shift, the shift can be on the axis, it can be on the level, I mean eye level, low level, and high level, and eye level, of course. Blocking is basically when you set up the camera and let the action, choreograph the action, basically. So that is blocking, when you say your subject to move from foreground to background during certain things, that's basically blocking. So you block the frame and you choreograph the action that is happening beyond, in front of the camera. Axis, again, you shift the axis, there's no axis, like in gravity, I would say. I mean, there's no axis in terms of camera. It's moving free flow, it's a free flow thing. So that's a variable axis camera technique. What camera angle does to a story in terms of aesthetics, it affects the story, it affects the mood. If you are shooting a very distorted frame, if you're shooting on a wide angle, very close to the subject, it'll give you a sense of claustrophobia, it'll give you a sense of uneasiness, basically, because the foreground, the nose will be swelled up and the back of the head will be narrower. So, I mean, that's how visual affects your memory and your sense. Emotion, Again, I mean, camera angles were very important in terms of emotion if you're shooting. Usually, it's the common language is when you're shooting a little high angle, you are sort of suppressing the character in a certain way. And if you're shooting low angle, you are empowering him in a certain manner. Eye level is a normal viewing of a character. Then again, the camera angle is very important in suggesting. So in a story, when you, it's not all about feeling. It's not all about what you're seeing and you're feeling. So sometimes the director or the filmmaker has to proactively suggest to the audience, and they have to basically tell that this is what you should feel at this point of time. So cinematography, sound, and everything comes. It becomes very important, light and everything. So again, like, can I show a clip?
Yeah, sure.
So, I'd like to show you a clip where, from the movie Matrix again, it's an introduction of Neo. Just try and register how the director and the cameraman have trying to give you a sense of confusion or the state of mind that the character is in, how they have through shots and music, how they have you know, given you that it's not objective. I mean, it's nothing close to real. I mean, it's not any basic grammar of, I mean, it's beyond basic grammar. It uses the you know, techniques that basic grammar would be used to say certain things, but then it's going beyond basic grammar, and that's where I think aesthetic comes into picture. So let's just see this clip and talk about it. Framing, I mean, the negative space is like almost overpowering the positive space. And that's the aesthetic working here. The movement of the camera, I mean, it's really unreal. I mean, no one looks like that, but just to evoke a sense. And the sound. And that's how.
Who is it?
So that's the introduction. Let's just see one more clip to see how mood is achieved. You see how this clip basically starts from a very light-hearted. I mean, the sound has a sense of something terrible. There's something uncanny in the sound, but the visuals are very happy at the starting, and towards the end you see the mood transform. So it's from happy to the couple basically are playing in the starting of the film. The couple is playing with the kids, and when the scene ends, the couple just gets to know that the child that they were playing with is now dead. So that's the emotion basically underlining the whole scene. Let's just see how the movements and everything works.
Legs too long, I don't know.
Let's leave more.
To have its own way. It finds reasons to be unhappy when all the world is shining around it. And love is smiling through all things.
Thank you.
the top angle. The pacing basically works there just to break the pace and give you that jerks because they're switching emotions very quickly. I mean, those jerks and sound accompanied with that gives you that liberty of suddenly jumping from one emotion to the other. I mean, that's one of the reasons where jump cuts could be used. I mean, one of the reasons.
Okay, my second question is, what do you understand by cinema score?
Cinema scope is an aspect ratio. As actually, it's the wider breadth than the length, basically. So the length is it's 16:9 is in terms of.
Is this just the aspect ratio or something more than that?
It's just the aspect ratio of cinema scope. Yeah.
Any lens that is actually required in the process of cinema scope?
If you're shooting, it depends, the combination is basically of the lens and the sensor. If you're shooting on a full frame, then you would need an anamorphic or a cine-series lens.
So do you know the procedure for using the anamorphic lens for CinemaScope?
Yes.
Can you explain that?
See, anamorphic is basically using these space. So the still photo lens, if you have a crop sensor, and you're using an anamorphic lens, it won't be very useful because it's the added information that won't, extra information that won't be recorded on the sensor. So if you have full frame sensor, is it a good idea to use an anamorphic lens, because then you have that extra space on the sides of the sensor, so that whatever, the difference between anamorphic and still is basically it's recording more details than the still camera, still lens, still photography lens. The anamorphic lens is giving you more details on the sides which a still photography lens would crop because of its diameter, because of its opening the aperture, because the light is narrower and it doesn't fall entirely on the sensor. So it's a good idea to use anamorphic with a full frame so that you get all the detail that you.
Okay, my last question, that if we have to play with the shutter speed or focal length or aperture, when we are moving our camera without stopping it, without pausing it, from a brighter exterior to darker interior, and we don't have any lights in the interior, so how to play with all these functions and make the subjects and objects visible in the interior?
See, there will be a jerk, because the difference in the light is too much, so there will be a jerk, but it's a good idea. There's a cine lenses available in the market which you don't have to, which is basically a remote, it's got a motor in the lens, and it switches aperture without giving any noise or without showing any jerks. Like in a still photography lens, you'll hear a click sound, and the exposure will cut down one stop with a jump. In a cine lens, you have the liberty to use those half stops, the quarter stops, everything. So I think in a situation like you described, it'll be a good idea to use a cine lens and slowly opening up the aperture as you go inside and exposing the inside, because camera would take a few milliseconds to adjust to the light. And if you are really in sync with the movement, with the aperture opening and the timing that you enter the darkness, I think it'll work.
Can you explain the 200mm lens and what was the use in films?
200mm is, again, it's a telephoto lens. The basic use is to get closer to a subject, still staying far. That's the general, the very technical approach towards lens. But when it comes to the aesthetics, because it's compressed, I mean, the angle of view is very less. You're not seeing too much of the background, so it's good at isolating subjects. It's good at because it gives you a very shallow depth of field. It's very good at evoking emotions such as love, maybe loss. A lot of emotions can be worked out. I mean, even comedy can be brought out with the telephoto lens. So I mean, it's just how you use it with colors and everything. Yeah, I think that's
fine. How can you innovate the Indian class new techniques, and how to satisfy their students with the new techniques?
See, I think the basic idea is to just understand the, see, again, cinematography, filmmaking, cinema, it's a language. I mean, language cannot be entirely taught. I mean, nothing perfection is like a redundancy when it comes to language. I mean, it cannot be perfect. That's where poetry comes in, when you...
What is the language of cinematography?
The angles, the
what type
lensing,
of angles? What
how the angle. I mean, angle is the language. So if you're shooting a subject from a top angle, so that's saying something. That's, if you're shooting from a low, but that is also saying something.
How can you describe in your class, actually?
Sorry?
How can you describe in your class these things?
I can describe, I can show them clips, I can...
Yes, you will.
I mean, that's the only way to... I mean, you can tell as much as you want, but until unless you don't see it happen. And I would say that whatever I say, I mean, it needs to be verified, only then the understanding will actually happen at a deeper level.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.